It was a plane that the United States Army Air Forces didn't even ask for. Yet the Douglas XB-42 Mixmaster was designed as a vision of the future, and it was such a bold departure from conventional bombers that it was impossible to ignore. As an embodiment of the Douglas Aircraft Company's aggressive and forward-thinking approach, the XB-42 boasted a radical streamlined design with a unique pusher configuration and inline engines. It was a strange aircraft, with an appearance far different from its contemporaries. But these features were not merely aesthetic. Not only did the XB-42 promise unmatched velocity with top speeds over 100 miles per hour faster than other bombers of the era, but it also offered the possibility of operating at much longer ranges, revolutionizing aerial bombardment strategy by allowing it to penetrate far behind enemy defenses. While the aircraft's potential was curtailed by the rapid onset of jet technology and the end of the war that it was designed to fight in, its legacy endures as a fascinating chapter in the annals of aviation history. During World War II, America's daylight precision bombing missions, designed to hit specific military and industrial targets and weaken the Axis forces, heavily depended on the Boeing B-17 Flying Fortress and the consolidated B-24 Liberator. The B-17 could carry up to 4,800 pounds of bombs. The B-24, with its more efficient wing design and higher-powered engines, could carry up to 8,000 pounds. Both could inflict substantial damage on their targets. Both aircraft were equipped with multiple defensive gun positions, providing them with stiff protection against enemy fighters. Nevertheless, as the war raged on, the need emerged for a bomber with a longer range that would allow the United States Army Air Force to extend the reach of bombing missions, perhaps even eliminating the use of forward bases, which were often difficult to secure and maintain. With this in mind, Boeing followed the B-17 with the B-29 Superfortress, which had an impressive maximum range of 3,250 miles compared to its predecessor's 2,000 miles. However, this B-29 was not only enormous, with a length of 99 feet and a wingspan of 141 feet, but the project also cost a staggering $3 billion, making it the most expensive of the entire war and severely limiting the aircraft's viability. At the same time, it had become evident that many bombers were extremely vulnerable to interception by faster, more agile enemy fighter planes. The top speeds of the B-17 and the B-24 were 287 and 290 miles per hour, respectively. The German Messerschmitt Bf 109 topped out at 390 miles per hour. The Focke-Wulf Fw-190 reached 408 miles per hour, an obvious problem. This vulnerability not only threatened the success of bombing missions, but also led to significant losses of aircraft and crew. If the Allies could develop faster bombers, it would reduce the time window during which enemy fighters could intercept and attack them. Higher speeds were believed to allow bombers to operate without the need for fighter escorts, which was particularly important during the early years of the war when most fighters had limited range and, therefore, would not be able to accompany bombers on missions deep in enemy territory. In 1943, Douglas Aircraft Company, which, along with Vega, had been part of the consortium that had assisted Boeing with the production of the B-17, recognized this demand for a bomber that had the longer range of the B-29, yet would be smaller and more cost-effective. What's more, by exploring ways to minimize aerodynamic drag and enhance propulsion efficiency, they believed it would be possible to create a medium bomber that could achieve a top speed of 400 miles per hour. This would be significantly faster than the Allies' current options in this category and have a much better chance of evading enemy fighters. Taking the initiative, Douglas began developing an aircraft that they believed would fulfill these criteria despite the lack of a formal solicitation from the military. Instead of tweaking an existing design, Chief of Engineering Edward F. Burton and his team planned a brand new aircraft from scratch, creating a bomber that would represent a significant break from all that had come before it. The design they finally settled on, initially known as Model 459, but soon given the name XB-42, had a 70-foot 6-inch wingspan, was 53 feet 8 inches long, and had a number of unconventional features that aimed to optimize aerodynamic efficiency and performance. The most distinctive aspect of the aircraft was its propulsion system. Instead of a traditional wing mount, it utilized a pair of Allison V1710 engines stuffed into the fuselage. The 12-cylinder liquid-cooled inline engines were already well known for their use in aircraft, such as the Lockheed P-38 Lightning. Each engine was cooled by intakes on the leading edge of the wings, with the radiators located in the fuselage, and came equipped with a variable speed supercharger. They were connected to counter-rotating coaxial three-blade Curtiss electric propellers located at the tail via long shafts, similar to the two-section shafts found in the Bell P-39 Air Cobra, which led to a reduction in the gearbox. Douglas aimed for the propellers to have independent and automatic control, along with a reversible pitch to reduce landing distances and control dive speeds. These propellers gave the XB-42 its unofficial but widely used nickname Mixmaster after the popular kitchen mixer, which some said the propellers resembled. To avoid risks to crew members needing to bail out, particularly the danger of being thrown into the rear propellers, the design included an explosive mechanism to detach the props from the tail cone during emergencies, enhancing safety during egress. The XB-42's unconventional pusher configuration, combined with the clean, unobstructed wing design, contributed to lowering the aerodynamic drag to just 70% of that of a conventional twin-engine bomber with tractor propellers. It also placed the aircraft's expected top speed at sea level at 344 miles per hour, with a projected maximum speed of 410 miles per hour at 23,800 feet. Its operational range at 10,000 feet was about 1,840 miles, which could be extended to 5,400 miles by reducing the bomb load and carrying additional fuel, making it well suited to missions that went far beyond enemy lines. In addition, the Mixmaster featured a tricycle landing gear arrangement, which was becoming more common in military aircraft designs of the time due to the improved forward visibility and handling characteristics it offered on the ground. The aircraft's all-metal construction and laminar flow airfoil wings were also indicative of the advanced design principles applied to new aircraft development during the period. Its full four-surface cruciform tail featured a lower fin and rudder assembly to ensure the aircraft's coaxial propellers did not come into contact with the ground. Contrasting with most USAAF bombers of the time, which often had crews of up to 10, the XB-42 was to be manned by just three individuals: a pilot, a co-pilot gunner, and a bombardier. They were positioned in unpressurized compartments, with the pilot and co-pilot gunner sitting side by side under distinctive bubble canopies offering excellent visibility, while the bombardier was stationed in a glazed section at the very front of the aircraft, behind a transparent nose made of plexiglass. The co-pilot's seat could rotate a 180 degrees to allow the operation of the gun control system. Internally, the XB-42 was designed to carry bombs with a combined weight of up to 8,000 pounds, a powerful payload comparable to that of many much larger and more conventional bombers of the day. Meanwhile, defensive armament was minimal, avoiding the heavy armed turrets often found on contemporary bombers. There were a pair of Faust 50-inch or 12.7mm machine guns on each side, integrated into the wing's trailing edge, with the option to retract into the wings when not needed. Their aim was controlled by the co-pilot using a special sighting station at the back of his cockpit. These guns' range of motion was restricted to 25 degrees to either side and could be elevated between 20 and 15 degrees, providing a limited coverage area to the rear only. Given the aircraft's impressive speed, it was anticipated that enemy fighters would be less likely to engage from other positions. Still, The XB-42 was also designed with provisions for two additional forward-facing guns. With the design complete by May 1943, Douglas unveiled their innovative aircraft concept to the USAF, who responded with great enthusiasm. This led to their decision on June 25, 1943, to commission two prototype models along with a static test airframe. With the first prototype ready less than a year later, the XB-42 took off for the first time on May 6, 1944, at Palm Springs Army Airfield in California, piloted by Bob Brush, with Lieutenant Colonel Henry E. Warden serving as the co-pilot. Throughout 32 test flights, the aircraft was carefully studied to make improvements. The second prototype, which made its maiden flight on August 1, 1944, from Santa Monica Airfield, also in California, featured several differences. The experimental individual bubble canopies were switched for a more traditional single canopy design with the goal of improving communication between the crew members, and the nose was covered in plywood after the plexiglass was shown to have a tendency to crack. In a bid to lighten the aircraft and increase its speed, it was fitted with hollow propeller blades, but these turned out to exacerbate existing problems with vibration, especially when the bomb bay doors were open or the gear and flaps were deployed. The tail was also enlarged in an attempt to counteract the original prototype's tendency to Dutch roll, a combination of uncommanded yaw and roll, and the inlets in the wing's leading edges were also made bigger to improve airflow, helping to maintain the engine's cool. However, just 2 weeks after the second prototype first took to the skies, the Japanese officially surrendered, bringing World War II to an end. With the urgency for its completion now significantly reduced, the XB-42 project was sidelined. The USAF began turning its attention to the development of bombers with the latest cutting-edge jet technology instead, such as the North American B-45 Tornado. Nevertheless, Douglas's test pilots accumulated 70 hours in the air with the second Mixmaster prototype before officially handing it over to the USAF in October 1945, where Lieutenant Colonel Fred J. Ascani and Captain Glenn W. Edwards took the helm, adding another 48 hours of flight time. Most of their flights took place at Muroc Army Airfield in California, which would later be renamed in honor of Edwards following his tragic demise in the Northrop YB-49 crash. While the aircraft didn't hit its expected performance marks, falling short of reaching its designed maximum speed and range, it did satisfy the expected rate of climb at sea level, manage the service ceiling on two engines, and adhere to the takeoff and landing distance requirements when clearing a 50-foot obstacle. It also showed promise in its overall stability, maneuverability, and stall characteristics, and Ascani observed that it was notably quieter than many other aircraft due to the placement of the propellers at the back of the plane. On December 8, 1945, Edwards and Warden achieved a new milestone in the second XB-42 prototype by completing a record-setting coast-to-coast flight across the United States, taking off from Long Beach, California, and landing at Bowling Field in Washington, D.C., around 2,300 miles in just over 5 hours and 15 minutes. The USAF proudly announced that the aircraft maintained an impressive average speed of 433 miles per hour during this journey. However, it was not disclosed that this speed was significantly aided by strong tailwinds encountered along the route, and the aircraft's true airspeed was closer to 375 miles per hour, though this was still considered fast for a bomber. Sadly, just 8 days later, tragedy struck. On December 16th, it was Ascani's turn to fly the aircraft, this time accompanied by Major Hayduck and Lieutenant Colonel Haney. The flight took a turn for the worse right from the start, as Ascani was forced to use the emergency system to retract the landing gear after takeoff from Bowling. About 40 minutes into the flight, the cockpit began to fill with smoke, and the instrument readings indicated that the engines were overheating. Then, in a worrying sequence, both engines failed one after the other. Ascani instructed the other two men to evacuate the aircraft using their parachutes, which they did safely. Hayduck at 1,200 feet and Haney at 800 feet. Just as Ascani was preparing to bail out himself, he realized he hadn't ejected the propellers, a necessary step to prevent his companions from potentially colliding with them. Quickly, he activated the mechanism to detach the props and the heavy gearbox, which dramatically altered the aircraft's balance and sent it into a sharp nosedive. Ascani managed to exit the plane at 400 feet, barely high enough for his parachute to open properly. He landed in Oxon Hill, Maryland, close to where the XB-42 eventually crashed. Incredibly, all three men survived, but the Mixmaster was completely destroyed. The subsequent investigation pinpointed a malfunction in the hydraulic system as the culprit for the landing gear issue. The exact cause of the engine failures remained a mystery, though fuel shortage was suspected for the right engine's malfunction. The investigation cleared Ascani of any responsibility for the incident. Meanwhile, the first and now only surviving XB-42 prototype underwent a transformation with the installation of two Westinghouse J-30 jet engines mounted in pods beneath its wings, evolving into the XB-42A. This modification boosted its speed, allowing it to reach a top speed of 480 miles per hour. However, this still didn't match the speeds of emerging all-jet designs, including the XB-43 Jetmaster designed by Douglas themselves. Consequently, the XB-42 project was canceled. By 1949, the last remaining unit was eventually retired by the U.S. Air Force and handed over to the National Air and Space Museum in Washington, D.C. In 2010, the aircraft's fuselage found a new home at the National Museum of the United States Air Force in Dayton, Ohio, where it awaits restoration and the opportunity to be displayed in the museum's experimental aircraft hangar as a bold testament to innovative World War II aviation technology that was not afraid to take risks.